The COVID-19 pandemic has stressed the semiconductor supply chain, and manufacturers are feeling the pinch. Mario Morales, the Program Vice President for Enabling Technologies and Semiconductors at IDC, is going to join me today to discuss how the semiconductor shortage, or the chip shortage, is affecting consumers and the tech industry. Stick around. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to Today in Tech. I'm Juliet Beauchamp, and I'm here with Mario Morales. As I mentioned, Mario, thank you so much for calling in and joining me today.
Thank you very much for having me on your program.
So the first question, and you can keep it pretty brief, how exactly did we get here? How and why is the semiconductor supply chain in such dire straits?
I think you really have to go back to last year. And I think we started really with the shock of the pandemic itself. And that really shut the world down for at least a quarter. And during that same period of time, areas like the industrial sector or the automotive sector completely shut down. And it forced suppliers to look elsewhere to continue to drive their own supply.
It's interesting that the chip shortage has affected the supply chain in such a way that is it kind of twofold, in that it was an issue because of a lot of people buying devices, you know, let's say last March, April, May, June, and also just by nature of the fact that because there was a pandemic, a lot of production had to cease.
Well, it's a combination of things. I think in general, the demand itself was very uneven. So at the beginning of the pandemic, we saw very strong demand for cloud infrastructure. Then we saw strong demand for broadband equipment. Then you saw PCs because everyone was moving to remote work or learning, right? So that drove a dramatic impact to the supply chain. But it's not all about just the demand side of things. I think what you need to also focus on is the fact that the industry as a whole was going through this period where it had to develop its continuity planning. And in some cases, some companies just perform better than others. If you look at areas like the automotive industry, this industry has, especially in Europe and in the US, they work in a more just-in-time kind of environment. And that usually works very well when in normal conditions. But when you have a shock like we did last year, mm-hmm. it just completely disrupted their supply chain. So that's why some of the worst cases are actually in areas like automotive or industrial sectors, which have very long product life cycles, but have a very complex and actually inefficient supply chain. And so it's taking some time, much longer than it would in the IT world, to recover.
I'm curious. I feel like this is something that has been in the news in the last few months, certainly. Is this a new problem? Are all of the issues from last year catching up to us now? And if that's the case, why now?
I think in general, it takes about a year for the supply chain to actually adjust. And I think, you know, if, you know, everyone really forgot about the fact that in 2019, the semiconductor industry as a whole was going through a very large correction. So for 2019, there was a lot of inventory across the board and demand was pretty uneven during that period of time. So the actual semiconductor industry declined by about 11%. As we got into 2020, we were expecting to see a gradual recovery for the semiconductor space, but then you got hit by the shock of the pandemic. And so that sort of just unraveled a lot of constraints that were already building up from the supply chain overall. And that's where we're at today. I think in general, this industry goes through cycles, and either they're demand-driven cycles or supply-driven cycles. But one of the things that we're now uncovering with all of this is that there's been a lot of underinvestment in some areas, especially for mature technologies in the semiconductor space that are vital to areas like monitors and power management for a lot of these devices, analog technologies. Many of these different technologies actually use very mature process technologies. And in those areas, there hasn't been a lot of strong investment. You hear about TSMC and Intel and Samsung investing billions of dollars into this space, but a lot of it is towards the leading edge. I would say more than 80% of the investment goes to leading edge technologies. And a lot of the mature technologies are relegated with existing capacity. And so when you get a tight environment, that's what you sort of see is that the tightness is really across the mature technologies and not as severe as the leading edge areas where there's a lot more capital to be invested.
I know that there's a bit of a counterfeit concern now. What threat do counterfeits pose to both, you know, the tech industry and any sort of B2B enterprise, but and is there also a threat for consumers?
I wouldn't say the consumers will probably notice as much. I think that the threat is more to enterprises that are using a lot of this technology and not being able to identify it. So if you're committing to a specific spec or you want specific performance capabilities, but you're getting a part that doesn't meet those specs, then you start seeing degradation of a system or a device. And I think that's where you see the impact. But, you know, counterfeit ICs are not anything new. I think it's happened over the years, just like, you know, you see counterfeit software and pirated software as well. I think it's just something that's just a cost of doing business in this area. And some of these parts definitely are re-engineered parts, but they just don't meet the specs that are intended to meet. And so that's why you see some of this during periods of tightness like that. People are definitely trying to take advantage of the tight situation.
So what kind of constraints are facing any company that relies on a semiconductor to produce their hardware product? And how is that constraint going to affect buyers? Is it going to drive up prices? Is there going to be less availability? And is that happening now? Is that going to happen next month? Is it going to happen next quarter?
Yeah, I think that in general, you'll see an increasing in prices, at least for the remainder of this year. Mm-hmm. So raw materials are increasing in price. So areas like substrates that are required for packaging or to sort of put on top of a chip as you design the package around it. These substrates, again, these are industries that have been underinvesting in the last couple of years. And now that you see this influx of all this demand, they just can't meet that supply. So the costs are going to go up for a lot of suppliers. And so you've seen that in the last couple of quarters. We've seen increases in wafer prices, increases in substrates. And it's just the lead times themselves are being pushed out because you just can't get these parts. You can't get the material to build the things that you want to build. So when you look at it from a consumer standpoint, the consumers probably will not see the pinch of this shortage as much, other than not being able to get enough of the products that they want to buy.
Sure.
So if they want the latest and greatest, it'll take some time for them to get it. But they probably will not see an increase at this point because it's still a very volatile economy, not just in the U.S., but you look around the world, we're just beginning to recover. So if you start seeing this dramatic inflation in electronic devices and systems, it could have an immediate impact on demand. I mean, we're seeing that inflation be an important part in areas like energy today. If you go to the grocery store now, you're paying probably 15 to 30% more for the goods that you're buying. And I think you can't see that for electronic devices, because if you do, they're just not going to buy as much. And so I think that suppliers are going to be very careful how they manage through this. And I think it's just going to take a little bit longer in time. And in some industries like automotive will probably take even longer because they've moved to the back of the line. You know, when you look at automotive, it gets so much press in terms of, you know, the impact of the shortages. But the reality is that the automotive industry only drives about 8.2% of the total semiconductor market.
Sure.
There are larger markets that will get priority. And suppliers are also a little bit upset from the fact that during the period of shutdown, many of these OEM vendors actually pushed out or completely canceled orders from these suppliers. And so the suppliers were fortunate enough that demand was vibrant across the board. So they were able to move their capacity to these other product lines. But now the automotive industry is sort of at the back of the line. And in general, you'll see some easing effect by the end of this third quarter. But the automotive market will probably take into 2022 before you see it recovery, because it's still inefficient. And you still have to see the products move upstream into the industry.
Great. So I think, just sort of speaking more broadly as we wrap up here, I guess my main question is, how do we, or how does the semiconductor industry, or how does the tech industry, the automotive industry, smartphone, PC, what have you, prevent this from happening again? Was this really just a one-off because of, you know, COVID-19 really presenting a perfect storm? Or is this something that, if there is some sort of, you know, either natural disaster, hurricane, tsunami, what have you, or another pandemic, is this mostly something that is only going to happen in times of disaster, or is this something that could happen again? If so, how should both the semiconductor industry and also anyone who's buying from the semiconductor industry plan ahead or prevent that?
I think that it will happen again. I think that there's so many interdependencies across the supply chain. Now, not only are you seeing large companies invest very large dollars into these industries, but they usually get the timing wrong. Sometimes when the capacity comes online, it's during a period where the demand side of the equation is contracting. And so a lot of that really means better continuity planning across the board, from vendors to suppliers to the companies that are delivering these products directly to the customer. Understanding the shifts that we've seen, even last year with the pandemic, the shift in buying behavior of consumers and figuring out what is essential to them and what isn't. I think that's going to be important to be able to forecast more accurately what demand really looks like and being able to then meet that forecast with supply. But I think a lot of this really comes down to collaboration across the supply chain, but this will happen again. This industry is a very large industry now. It's almost a half a trillion in size, and it'll continue growing at least over the next 5 years, about 5% growth. So it's an industry that definitely is very essential. But I think that these supply and demand cycles continue to be a sort of a normal part. Every couple of years, you sort of see this. And I think one of the learnings that we're going to find from this time around is that there's a lot of interdependencies among the different technologies. It's not just about chasing the next technology, but also making sure that you have enough investment for the existing and mature technologies, because maybe you have a very advanced system that you're building and you can get the latest and greatest CPU on it. But if you need a $2 part that does the power management or the regulation of the voltage, and you can't get that part, you can't ship that system, right? Yeah. And you're going to find the same thing within any industry. So I think just the business continuity planning, the forecasting, I think has to get better, and a better understanding also of the demand dynamics by the entire supply chain.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Mario. I really appreciate your time. I think you provided a really nice overview of kind of how we got here and who it's affecting and where the tech industry goes from here. So thank you so much for joining me. I really appreciate it.
Thank you very much, Julia, for inviting me. I appreciate the time.
And thank you all so much for watching this episode of Today in Tech. If you like this video, please do give it a thumbs up. And you can subscribe to our channel so you never miss an episode. You can hit the bell icon so you're notified every single time we post a new video, which is just about every weekday. If you have any questions or comments about the chip shortage, please do let us know in the comments below. I'm interested to hear your thoughts. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next time.